Welcome everyone to the launching ceremony of Tan Sri Omar Center for Science, Technology and Innovation Policy Study. My name is Ruben and I'll be the MC this morning. First and foremost, allow me to welcome our guests of honor and panelists. Young Professor, Dr. Peter, Vice Chancellor and Founder of UCSI University. Young Professor, Dr. Omar Abdul Rahman, Member, UCSI University Council. Young Professor, Professor Dr. Abu Bakar Jaafar, Chairman, Malaysian Green Technology and Climate Change Center. Yang Berbahagia, Datin Dr. Amin Al-Zanan, Founding Editor-in-Chief, The Petri Dish. Yang Berusaha, Professor Dr. Muhammad Tajuddin Muhammad Rasdi, School of Architecture and Built Environment, UCSI University. Yang Berusaha, Girish M. Ramachandran, Executive Director, 27 Advisory. Forum Moderator, Yang Berbahagia, Professor Datuk Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim, UCSI University. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, good morning and welcome everyone to the launching ceremony of Tan Sri Omar Center for Science, Technology and Innovation, short for STI. STI is an important agenda, and it is in fact a national policy in place to advance Malaysia to a competitive and competent nation. The launch of this center is timely and even more pressing. It belongs to UCSI, a leading private university in Malaysia. UCSI University is ranked in the top 250 in the world and is among the top 1.1% of the world's universities. Offering over 110 programs in various fields, the university today has taken another leap forward by launching the center that is in line to drive further growth among our students, societies, and ultimately the nation. We converge this morning in this virtual setting to listen to our guests of honor, as well as our esteemed panelists, who will later be speaking on the topic of powering the nation's agenda for harmonious, prosperous, progressive, and sustainable Malaysia, the strategic role of science, technology, and social innovation. Without further ado, I pass the next session to Professor Datuk Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim. Welcome, Professor Datuk Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim.
Thank you very much, Ruben, for that introduction. First, I would like to thank the leadership of the university, especially our Vice Chancellor and founder, Dr. Peter. And I would like to welcome the top
recording
management.
Recording in progress.
And of course, Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Dr. Omar Abdul Rahman. The idea of this center was mooted quite a few years back. And we are fortunate that this has become a reality. Basically, the center is to provide a platform for researchers at UCSI working with partners in Academy Science of Malaysia and other universities to study or to do a critical study of various policies that affect the nation. So we are structured as a working committee, where I'll be actually coordinating the working committee, which brings together deans from the faculties of the university. And we have an advisory committee, which is chaired by Tan Sri Omar. And this advisory committee is to actually advise us on the kind of projects that we pursue. And with this platform, we hope to actually produce publications, books, and intervention on policy matters with regards to the various policies of the government. And as we can see, all policies of the country must have that element of science, technology, and innovation. So far, we have got a very good response from our faculty. In fact, at the first advisory committee meeting coming up, we'll be presenting two very important projects to be considered. One is on food security, which will be championed by the Faculty of Applied Science. And the other one is looking at our response to the Belt and Road Initiative. This will be headed by the business group. So we hope to actually use this platform to widen our involvement in policy research in the country. And as we know, all that matters to any nation is the right policy to drive development. And we are fortunate that Tan Sri Omar, who needs no introduction in the circle of the science and technology fraternity, has agreed to lend his name to this very important center. And I believe the launching of this center will mark another milestone in the journey of UCSI to be among the top research university in the country. Thank you very much, Ruben.
Thank you, Professor Dato' Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim. Next up, I invite Dato' Peter Ng, Vice Chancellor and founder of UCSI University, to deliver his speech. Ever passionate about learning and embracing new technologies in moving forward, Dato' Peter is a leader who's committed to groom tomorrow's leaders with exceptional qualities to thrive in whichever settings that they may be in. Welcome, Dato' Peter.
Thank you, Ruben. Academician Professor Emeritus Tan Sri Dr. Omar Abdul Rahman, UCSI University Council Member, Professor Datuk Engineer Dr. Abu Bakar Jaafar, Chairman of the Malaysian Green Technology and Climate Change Center, Mr. Girish M. Ramachandran, Executive Director of 27 Advisory, Dating Dr. Mahalakshmi Arujana, Founding Editor-in-Chief of the Petri Dish, Malaysia's first science newspaper, members of UCSI University's top management team, esteemed professors, honored colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning and welcome to the launch of the Tan Sri Omar Center for Science, Technology and Innovation Policy Studies. We should be having a grand launching ceremony at UCSI University, but we live in challenging times. Tan Sri, we will hold a more befitting reception center when the situation permits. I would like to start by thanking Tan Sri Dr. Omar for christening the center with his name. As the first science advisor to the Prime Minister and the founding president of the Academy of Sciences Malaysia, he is widely respected, not only in Malaysia, but around the world. Science, technology, and innovation, or STI for short, are his calling cards, and he continues to champion them at every opportunity. He also has an abiding interest in sustainability, and his enthusiasm is infectious. I have had the privilege of serving alongside Tan Sri Dr. Omar on the UCSI University Council, and I'm most impressed by his insights and contributions. But his input and guidance, I'm convinced that the center will go on to make a pertinent contribution to STI policy making in Malaysia. The past 1.5 years show that sound STI policies are solely needed, not only in Malaysia, but around the world. The way COVID-19 was handled or mishandled says it all. The entire world could see that China's dramatic lockdown last January was serious. However, virtually every nation was slow and indecisive in their response. The lockdown of the world's most populous nation was supposed, supposed to buy the world time, but in the end, time just ran out. What started off as a serious epidemic soon morphed into a raging pandemic, and mighty nations were humbled by the lack of PPE and ventilators, indecisive public health policies, and a failure to curb misinformation. In hindsight, a robust policy framework could have helped everyone navigate the COVID-19 minefield. Cases could have been kept to a minimum, and the strain on healthcare systems could have been avoided. Ladies and gentlemen, hindsight is 2020, as they say. But while we can't change the past, we can work towards safeguarding the future. This realization is a driving force behind the center's inception. All of us at UCSI University want to contribute more on the policy front, not just thinking, but doing. Strategy and execution must go hand in hand for the best policies to be consequential. In this regard, we will ensure that the policies we develop must come with action plans. As we speak, our academics and researchers are already working on pertinent initiatives pertaining to energy, water, and climate change. The formation of the center will spur their efforts and connect them to their peers around the world. I would like to applaud the management of UCSI University for taking the initiative to establish a consortium on STI policy studies. The center presently partners with Academy of Sciences Malaysia, and plans are in the pipeline to link up with leading STI organizations in Europe. Ranked 347th in the 2020 QS World University Rankings, UCSI University is now classified in the top 1.1% of all universities worldwide. UCSI has climbed 141 spots from its original position in 2019, and we are clearly moving in the right direction. While this is reassuring, we know that the time has come to make a greater contribution to society, our nation, and the global community. Our students consistently show that they have what it takes. Renowned universities like Harvard, Imperial College London, Chicago, Tsinghua, RMIT, and Queensland annually select our top students for high impact research. Many of our alumni have also made a name for themselves as entrepreneurs, and three of them have been inducted into the Forbes 30 Under 30 Asia list. I firmly believe that the Tan Sri Omar Center for STI Policy Studies will be another invaluable launch pad for UCSI staff and students. This applies particularly to our growing postgraduate cohort. Malaysia has some pressing scientific, economic, social, and environmental issues. And by committing to the task at hand, our students will embrace the opportunity to contribute to national progress, harmony, and sustainability. This is the hallmark of all great universities, and I'm heartened that UCSI will now operate actively on this front. The road ahead may be long, and we cannot guarantee that we will come up with all the right answers all the time, but we can promise that we will seek them with all our strength, actively, responsibly, and urgently. Thank you very much. Let's get the center launched.
Thank you, Dr. Peter. Next, I invite Tan Sri Omar Abdul Rahman to deliver his launching speech and to subsequently launch this ceremony. Tan Sri Omar is a Malaysian academician and a corporate figure. He has contributed immensely to the field of science and has received numerous awards from universities in Australia, the UK, and Canada, among others. Welcome, Tan Sri.
Thank you, Robin. Thank you, Dr. Peter, for the kind remarks. And thank you to everyone, to colleagues, to friends, to some of them who are my students as well. I would like to say that I spend a big part of my working life in government, dealing with science policy and related matters, and having an opportunity to contribute towards establishing and strengthening the science policy and the STI ecosystem for Malaysia. My working definition of policy is simply a declaration of intent with justification. This being the starting point of any initiative, undertaking, or endeavor. This, however, is the simple part. The big challenge is implementation, translating intention into action, and successful completion require an optimal capacity. This involves a whole host of dedicated players and competent enablers. I will describe some of these in my presentation later while setting the scene. I became aware of our deficiencies and felt the need and had wish for trained professional in science policy matters. The situation hasn't improved much today. So when UCSI University decided to establish a center for STI policy studies, it was a wish come true for me. To have the center named as it is a great honor. And I thank the university most sincerely for its magnanimity. And this morning I am asked to launch the center. This must be the proverbial blowing one's own trumpet. But I will do this honor with all humility. In the capable hands of its coordinator, Professor Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim and his team, and under the guidance of its advisory committee, I am confident the center will be an important component of the country's STI ecosystem and a valuable asset to UCSI University. It is now my singular honor to formally launch the Tan Sri Omar Center for STI Policy Studies at UCSI University. Thank you.
Thank you, Tan Sri. The Tan Sri Omar Center for Science, Technology, and Innovation Policy Studies is now officially launched. Thank you everyone for witnessing the launch of this important event that is set to spark creativity and innovation within and around the university. Next, we move on to the forum. I welcome Professor Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim, an academic and a columnist with a keen interest in innovation, technology, and sustainable goals to moderate this session. Welcome, Professor.
Thank you very much, Ruben, for that introduction. First of all, I would like to thank all who have agreed to come forward and participate in this forum, a very important forum, especially at this time when we are just in a time when we are changing government. So the topic of empowering science technology to drive the nation's sustainability, prosperity, and social improvement is a big topic that should be useful to all the participants at this time of the nation's period as we approach Independence Day, 31st August. And I would like to thank the panelists, Dr. Abu Bakar Jaafar, who is the chairman of Malaysian Green Technology Corporation and Climate Change, Mr. Girish Ramachandran, who is from the private sector. He's got a company, a consultant company of his own. And we have Datin Mala, who is actually heading a communication group, doing a lot of science communication on biotechnology and the rest. And of course, our own Professor Tajuddin Rasdi, who is now our celebrity actually for UCSI. He's known in the country for his vision and his voice, his opinion, and a lot of matters related to the social aspect. So thank you once again. To start off the forum, what we'll do is we have Tan Sri Omar to give a scene-setting presentation about the topic. And after his presentation, I will invite the panelists one by one to actually express their views about the topic in relation to many factors: communication, sustainability, industry development, and of course, social innovation. So can we please invite Tan Sri Omar first to set the scene for this very important topic of the forum.
Thank you.
Please, Tan Sri.
Thank you, Dr. Setting the scene, I call the presentation Strengthening the National Science, Technology, and Social Innovation Capacity to Deliver a Harmonious, Prosperous, Progressive, and Sustainable Malaysia. Okay, next, please. As an introduction, the centrality of STI in socioeconomic transformation of any country is universally accepted. STI being a major enabler alongside the political, the economic, and the social enablers. National SET, socioeconomic transformation. Next one. National SET objectives are determined by national aspirations, whatever way they are politically articulated. In our case, the overarching goals of our national aspiration, from Rukun Negara to Vision 2020 to the current Shared Prosperity Vision 2020, can be summarized as a national agenda for a harmonious, prosperous, progressive, and sustainable Malaysia, HPPS. In this discussion, we will focus on strengthening the national capacity in STI and social innovation to deliver an HPPS Malaysia. Next one, please. Now, what are the requirements for being harmonious? There are three components that I recognize. Firstly, of course, meeting the basic needs of the citizen. Example, food, water, shelter, energy, basic education, primary healthcare, gainful employment. And then, of course, improving quality of life, higher level of basic needs. But a very important part is what I call the social, cultural, spiritual component. The way we behave, the way we interact with one another in a society like ours, multiracial, multicultural, multireligious, and a real masyarakat majmuk. That's a very, 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 very important component, the socio-cultural, spiritual element. I've been promoting this under another hat which I wear, which is Dialogue Rakyat for National Cohesion and Unity, promoting the way we should behave toward each other. Next one, the requirement for being prosperous. Prosperity is reflected in opportunities for personal involvement, improvement, equitable income distribution derived from a robust, high-income, innovation-driven, private sector-led economy, healthy, productive, and harmonious lifestyle. Harmonious Musra being the way we should relate to one another as individuals and as groups of individual citizens. Next one, being progressive. Being progressive to me is being an active part of the present, an influential part of the future on the global stage, to be future aware and to be future ready. And then of course, sustainable. It is about being aware, to understand, to commit and to act. Actionable, sustainable practices at all levels of society and government. Now the overall requirement for HPPS, Harmonious, Prosperous, Progressive and Sustainable Malaysia is good governance and responsible government. And the overall enablers for HPPS, as we said earlier, are the political, the economic, the social, and the technological. In summarizing, the technological enablers for HPPS can be grouped into four critical technologies. Technologies for satisfying basic needs. Next, please, yeah. Technologies for satisfying basic needs. Technologies for improving quality of life, which shall include those for environmental sustainability and mitigating emergencies. Technologies for economic growth and industrial competitiveness. And then technologies, of course, technologies for good governance. Issues of basic needs, quality of life, economic growth, and industrial competitiveness and good governance are very, very country specific. Securing the appropriate sets of the four critical technologies through what is known as make some or buy some, or through other means, and deploying them constitute the national STI agenda, implemented according to national priorities within the framework of the national STI policy, implementation strategies, and management practices. The involvement of all major national stakeholders, government, scientific community, private sector, and civil society is imperative if this task is to be implemented with any degree of success. For this reason, national science policy must relate to each of the stakeholder components. Next one. So the essential component for science policy will be STI for policy, identifying and prioritizing the STI enablers needed to deliver specific socioeconomic transformation policy objectives. And second one, policy for STI. If you want STI to support policy, then you must have policy to support STI. Then the next one is STI and the private sector, the measures to secure involvement of the private sector. STI and the community is next. Issues of science enculturation, in other words, to get the support of the science, of the citizen, of the public at large, to support and to appreciate science, STI. And then policy for collaboration in STI. Nowadays, you need a robust framework for not only just for national stakeholders, for international partners as well. And then finally, you need STI and government and governance, meaning mechanism and processes strengthening governance for STI and STI to support governance. Next one. Next one, The ultimate goal is for us to the ultimate goal for securing support and involvement of the major stakeholders in STI policy, implementation strategies, and management nexus is to achieve what I call the total national capacity in STI, so as to be efficient enablers to deliver a harmonious, prosperous, progressive, and sustainable Malaysia. Next one. Now, what are the elements of total national capacity? These are as follows. A government committed to providing a comprehensive STI physical and soft infrastructures and the required resources. Secondly, a scientific community, technological and technological community, ethical and competent, and able to contribute to and draw from the global pool of scientific knowledge and technological know-how. Thirdly, a private sector capable of creating wealth through the application of technology and innovation in both traditional and new sectors of the economy. Next one is a society that is at least or at ease with science, literate, supportive, and imbued with a culture of creativity, innovativeness, and entrepreneurship. And finally, an efficient governance system, enabling effective policy making, planning, implementation, and public debate and international collaboration that ensures long-term commitment to STI development. That is the final objective we want to achieve in the STI ecosystem, the total national capacity. Next one. In order to implement any initiative successfully, a complete set of committed players with the right experience and expertise is required. Represented here as the human resource pyramid, the key players required to achieve TNC in STI are, first of all, the champions. These can be committed individuals, organizations, or institutions. A supreme champion, the head of government, may be needed to move a major national agenda like the TNC, Total National Capacity in STI. Otherwise, commitment may be only rhetorical. Next one will be the advisors. The advisors can be individuals or institutions. At the official level, the following are recognized as advisors: advisory councils, advisory committees, national academies, learned societies and networks, and chief scientific advisors. To which may be added a parliamentary select committee on STI. We do have one now, but we have never heard about them because we do not know what they are doing. In addition, there are independent structures such as STI policy studies and research centers in universities, similar foundations in the private sector and civil society organizations with interest in STI issues and social well-being. The next one in the pyramid are the popularizers. These are the communicators that bridge the gap between the scientific community and the general public, which is essential to the STI enculturation processes. The next one are the planners and the managers. They include policymakers responsible for developing the national STI agenda and action plan and for implementation and evaluation oversight. The next one in the pyramid are the educators, the teachers teaching science in schools and the academics in colleges and universities, teaching all the different professional and scientific disciplines. Last but not least are the bulwark of the resources that is required. These are the practitioners and the implementers, a whole range of STI workforce in government, in private sector, in educational institutions and in civil society, skilled workforce in relevant areas. Now, the social innovation component. The element of HPPS is not just STI-centric. They are also people-centric. Without support and involvement of civil society, particularly with respect to the harmonious and the sustainable component, it will be impossible to succeed. The sociological component, therefore, must be factored into policy, into the total national capacity, and into the human resource pyramid. Now, what role does the TSO Center at UCSI University? I see it as being a champion, as an advisor, as a popularizer, and as an educator. That is the role that our center should be playing. Next one after that, please. There you are, part of the pyramid. We are very much part of the pyramid. Next one, as an educator, the center should introduce at least two training programs to start with. The essential of STI policy, professional program for middle level management. And then total national capacity in STI, awareness program for top management, for top leadership. In addition, there should be opportunities for scholars to pursue master's and PhD degrees in STI and STI related areas. As an advisor, the center is classified as an independent STI policy organization, joining forces with other independent groups and the existing formal structures, adding strength to the capacity to advise government on STI and related issues. It can be argued, unfortunately, that currently this capacity to advise is not matched with capacity to receive and act on good advice. Therefore, for the government to consider strengthening its time, therefore, for the government to consider strengthening this capacity. Next one. One of the goals of the center, I hope, is to advocate for the strengthening of capacity to receive and to act on good advice on matters relating to national STI capacity, national STI agenda, policy implementation and strategies, management and evaluation nexus, crucial for achieving a harmonious, prosperous, progressive, and sustainable Malaysia. The center will advocate for the establishment of a national STI Action Council, not just an advisory council, with mandates for both the SMT and the social innovation component. Emphasis not action, on action, not just on advisory. Now, I thought we should consider the framework of the center's modus operandi. In discharging its various roles within the context of the human resource pyramid, the center will address the problematic of STI and SI capacity employing the ACCA plus E framework. This is about raising awareness, facilitating comprehension or understanding of the issues, encouraging commitment, advocating appropriate action, and mandating evaluation. The critical enabler roles of ST and SI in delivering HPPS cannot be overemphasized. Various platforms will be used to engage the major national stakeholders in order to achieve ACCA plus E and an optional national ST and SI capacity, science, technology, and social innovation capacity for a harmonious, prosperous, and sustainable Malaysia. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Tan Sri, for that very comprehensive coverage, setting the scene for our forum. I'm sure we all agree that the pandemic has been a very big disruptive force, not just on the economy, the livelihood, the health, and many other things. And of course, the most disrupted is society. If you look at what has been discussed, not just in Malaysia, all over the world, the togetherness of society, the harmony of society has been badly bruised during the pandemic. And if these are not addressed, the sustainability of the world is at stake. Sustainability now is a big, major concern for all nations, not just related to climate change, but the cohesiveness of society. To start off the discussion on the presentation by Tan Sri, can I first invite Dr. Abu Bakar Jaafar, who actually has been a strong advocate for sustainability all these years. I knew him when he was the DG of DOE, Department of Environment, years ago. And he has been all the time pushing this agenda of environmental compatibility with society. Please, Dato' Bakar. Can you please unmute, Dato'?
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Dato' Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim, my good friend. And first of all, I wish to thank the organizers for having me here this morning. This I must say, very auspicious occasion and memorable one. And let me take this opportunity also to thank, congratulate Tan Sri, Dato' Dr. Umar Abdul Rahman for him, that your name has, that this center for STI, UCSI Center for STI Policy, been named after you, Tan Sri. And I think personally, I've known Tan Sri since my bachelor days. I was staying in a house in Sedang, just a few doors from his house. And then when he was a first science advisor in the Prime Minister's department, I had the opportunity to work with him, being the desk officer to the EPU Inter-Agency Planning Group for Science Technology. For the fifth Malaysia plan. So I've known Tan Sri since then. I've been working closely with him. So actually, Tan Sri has laid down the very solid foundation for the center to move ahead with the rest of us. I don't think I have much comment, because his presentation very solid, very complete and very comprehensive. Yeah. Anyway, since I'm invited here as a chairman of Malaysian Green Technology and Climate Change Center, so I would like to share what essentially the center is doing in order to address the sustainability issues, and in particular in matters relating to green technology and climate change. And as we have heard earlier, Tan Sri has highlighted essentially the three basic pillars for sustainability and socioeconomic, the environment, sustainability, and also the aspect of on the social, cultural, and spiritual components. And is I must share the current MGTC Green Technology Plan. We have a number of programs, and one of the targets have been set by government is to reduce our carbon emission intensity by 45% from the 2005 level by 2030. And what this entails is the need for us to promote green growth, to promote the green investment, to create the green jobs, and also to promote the government green procurement products. And another aspect, what Tan Sri has touched, is very, to me, is very essential. It's a core issue, the subject relating to the governance. I think this is very important. We just have completed a study by the Academy of Sciences Malaysia, and we have reviewed the state of the environment in Malaysia, in particular, what Tan Sri is saying, the basic needs. To me, to us, the most basic needs of all, the need for the access to clean air and clean water, and not much progress has been made in the last few decades. I must say, when we reviewed the state of the environment, in particular the river water quality, the top three most polluted rivers have been the same since 1976, because most of the problems been tackled at the federal level, but much effort need to be done at the state and local levels. And I've been saying since late 80s, early 90s, I would say if a brunette were to jump into our rivers, she would most likely pop up as a blonde, because our rivers polluted, and number one pollutant is the total suspended solids. Our rivers still polluted, and I must say, out of 100 points we've been monitoring throughout the country, only 25% would be declared enough to support our need for potable drinking water. And in terms of air quality, we have improved so much, but still some outstanding issues, because we continue to depend on the fossil fuels. So one of the major pollutants is the particulate matter, especially those below 2.5 micrograms per cubic meter, micron, and this is still present. And also the high presence of ground level ozone, and this also due to the emissions of hydrocarbon into the air because of our continued dependency on the motor vehicles, internal combustion engines vehicle. So for us to move forward, then we need to promote green energy, including green hydrogen. As I would say, green hydrogen is going to be the most dominant energy carrier in this century. And I will conclude my remark by saying that in order to improve our governance, especially to strengthen our environmental governance, the Academy of Sciences Malaysia just completed a study I was saying earlier, and we have submitted our recommendations to the Ministry of Environment and Water. We now have proposed for the government to consider to establish what we call it the Federal State Commission for the Environment. The main function of the commission, other than to monitor, coordinate, harmonize the functions and roles of various federal states, environment authorities relating to environment. But I think the most important function, which is that is missing now, is the need to audit the performance of every federal and state agency relating to environment. And this commission would be effective with the support of the what we have proposed now, the establishment of state or interstate river basin authorities. So I'll stop here, and this is the most current our continuing efforts to address the subjects of environmental sustainability. So in short, we need to continue to improve our dependency not only fossil fuels, but on the renewable energy. This is one way to address the air pollution problems, especially particulate matters and the ground surface ozone. Then We need to have the river basin authority to improve the quality of our rivers. Otherwise, till today, we still see that our water supply gets disrupted. And this is due also to the presence of high solids and many, many water operators, their operation have been disrupted because of the continuing problems. So I'll stop here for the timing and Dato' Ahmad, and back to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dato'. Just to remind the participants, if you have questions, please write them on the chat group, on the chat box, and we'll take them after the panelists have gone through their remarks. We all know that sustainability is a big agenda for the world, but I'm sure you all agree there is no sustainability if society is always feeling the pain. If the society is disrupted, there can be no sustainability for the world. So it's not just about environment, because as you know, the three pillars of sustainability, environment, society, and progressive or prosperity. No one else can actually talk about the impact on society and how society should respond to this agenda of progressiveness and prosperity than our own Professor Muhammad Tajuddin Umar Rasdi. As I mentioned, he has been writing and has been an invited panelist for many occasions in the country to discuss the societal issues. Please, Prof.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera. Thank you very much, Dato' Ahmad. And I'm honored to be with all these experts in this today's forum. Now, I want to get into the idea of the presentation, where the Tan Sri, being a scientist, also being an academic, as well as being an administrator, the way that he presented it, you can see that you have the top-down approach. And the idea here is that if you have a clear procedure, backed by clear knowledge, like what Dato' Bakar was mentioning just now, then everything will be all right. Well, I'm sorry to say that it's not going to be all right, because in society, what works are what we call narratives. If you have a narrative of how you are to live, then that is the narrative that will take you on. And now, narrative is governed by religion, governed by culture. And if you do not put in the data of Dato' Abu Bakar and the procedure of Tan Sri Omar within a structured narrative of culture, religion, and spirituality, you can forget it, because that's not going to happen in society. Now, why is it like this? Is because of our education system. Buckminster Fuller, one of the great inventors in the United States and also in our architecture fraternity, mentions that one of the great failures of education is specialization, meaning that you put someone in the university in order to be an engineer, then he goes into becoming an engineer. Then you put someone as a doctor, then they become a medical doctor. And so this aspect of specialization disregards other knowledge. And we can see that when I ask students who have 4.0 valedictorian about aspects of humanism or humanity, this fail greatly in understanding. So next month in a global forum, I'm advocating the idea of a 60-20-20 into education. Now you can have 60% specialization of whatever engineering and subject matter, but you must have 20% of the credit into multidisciplinary, meaning you need to take other courses. If you're a science major, then it would have to be other the subjects of humanities and others. And music, arts, this to complete your education. And the other 20% is what I call the agenda of what my main topic was, global spirituality. Now, what is global spirituality? Global spirituality is an attempt to put on the education of religion, the education of values into our students so that they do not identify in an isolated manner that you're a Muslim and you're a Christian and you're a Buddhist and you this and that, this and that. Yes, you can still continue to practice whatever you have learned from your traditional idea of religion or political idea of religion, but there is this transcendence as well as a emergence of a value system. Now, why I have come to this conclusion is from looking at my own religion, Islam. For instance, we as Muslim are taught to be clean. And so cleanliness is part of spirituality. So some of the najis, things like, filth, and also one of them is about dogs. Okay, so it's all right for Muslims to consider a dog najis. But then there's something else happened. Some ustads begin to extend this cleanliness to, so don't go to houses where there are dogs, so you'll be safe. You know, so that destroys society. What's wrong with going to a house where there is a dog? Now, I have heard this from even politician excos when they profess this kind of ideas. Again, when I look at the Friday sermon, I have read, I think, 3,000 or 4,000 Friday sermons from Jakim, from Jaish, from Ais. None of the sermons talks about the idea not only of science and technology in relation to Islam, but also the idea of other religion, other values, the values of compassion, the values of helping other human beings, the values of helping a dog with no feet, like what my friend Harith Iskandar has done. He is a Muslim, but he adopted a dog that has somebody cut the two front legs, and he kept it. And I just said to him, look, if you ever go to heaven, it will be because of the dog, because, you know, the prophet said, the prostitute that gave drink to the dog is somebody which is a very, very good person. So the point here is that our education system has too much of this technology and too much of this science to the detriment of the idea of a wholesome individual. What the heck to do with the science and the technology in their hands? They are only very specific. Our academics are also the same thing. They can only talk about science. When I, in the promotion board, asked people who are lecturers who are going to be associate professor, I said, if you are going to write a book on the subject of, say, mechanical engineering, what would be your message to society? None of them can answer this question. No one can answer this question. Now, one of my favorite popularizer of science is Dr. Michio Kaku. Michio Kaku is a theoretical physicist, and he's at the forefront of science, but he's also someone who writes about predicting what the future is going to be like. And he's written, I think, more than 10 books, and I've read about 5 of them. It helps me understand one perspective of what the world might be. This aspect of multidisciplinary, not to say the idea of global spirituality, is totally, to me, non-existent in our education system. Whether you're looking at the teachers, whether you're looking at the professors, whether you're looking at the lecturers, what else are you going to expect from students? So this narrative of science and technology must be embedded within the construct. But the way it has been presented, it is number 4. Science, technology, environment, and then it's number 4. Well, it's actually not like that. It is something that it embeds in the consciousness and the awakening. For instance, the idea of the Sungai Kim Kim and almost killed 2,000 of our young students. Why was it led to be destroyed? Because people who see it, whether they are bureaucrats, whether they are industrialists, whether they are people, just see them as water flowing. That's all. they didn't see the grandeur of it. You know, when I watch videos of trails, walk trails in the United States, in Sweden, in Norway, where the trail brings millions of people to walk just to look at rivers and mountains, the idea of appreciating nature, being close to God. So the idea here of the environment and the idea of knowledge of science has been separated from the day one that we came to the school, even though we say that we are trying to do some integration, but it does not exist. It exists in a procedural sense. So I'll just end by saying that we have to structure our knowledge within a framework of humanity and consciousness of spirituality if we are to go to a positive direction with regard to a harmonious existence with not only ourselves, but also with the environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prof. Tajuddin. As we can see, the social dimension of sustainability is a very important element in achieving harmony, prosperity, progressiveness, and all this. And Prof. Tajuddin has just discussed many issues related to society. And if you look at one of the greatest challenges of the pandemic is how to change the behavior of people. This is a big problem. And of course, sustainability is also impacting strongly on the business community. The industry now will have to respond to the call by society for more sustainable practices in their operation. And maybe to respond to this issue of harmony, prosperity, and sustainability, Mr. Girish Ramachandran may be in a good position to say a few words about this. Please, Mr. Girish.
Thank you, Professor Dato. I think I've got a difficult task here going after Professor Tajuddin. But the good thing is, in 27 Group, our tagline is actually rebuilding humanity. Yeah, it's actually our tagline. And if you look at those two words, I think that's what we're trying to do now in Malaysia, right? We're trying to rebuild everything from the jobs that are lost, from household debt that is ballooning, government funding. And our GDP is not looking too good this year, with Finch showing it at 0% growth. So maybe I'd like to address this with a couple of angles and a way forward, which I think fits into UCSI's STI Center and what I heard. My solution is essentially we need to increase income. I think that's the solution that has to be solved now. And how do we do it with technology, science, and innovation? It's not too late. We have been talking heavily on the concept of an innovation district, which essentially brings academia, private capital, and industry. And each of these innovation districts, for one innovation job, creates 16 to 25 more jobs in the medium term. Now, we've got tremendous amount of policy documents in Malaysia already written. We have the SPV 2030, we have the 4IR Negara, we have the My Digital, and we have MOSTI's My STIE framework, as well as a national AI roadmap. And we're rolling out the most important infrastructure in Malaysia, which is the 5G. Now, with 5G, it changes the entire climate and dimension of Malaysia, yeah? And this is not something that people are talking about. People are already experimenting and doing things with 5G that improves humanity. You know, it can eradicate poverty in certain areas if you use it and you harness it. So my feel is we've got a good pizza base. I use this analogy of a pizza base, which is 5G, yeah? And if you look at rural agriculture, for example, what did water do to rural agriculture is the same thing that we see is going to happen with the 5G rollout. As long as we can get it out in time and cover a wider area in Malaysia, this is going to be a game changer. Now, as policy in place with all these documents, we heard about implementation. Yeah. I think we should leave the government alone, and I think private sector should move ahead fast. And if we were to place a bet on an economic sector in Malaysia, we feel it's agri-food. And I'm very happy to know that your UCSI and STI center is focusing on food security. And this is the goldmine here. Malaysia is not new to agri-food. Yeah, we are the ones in 1960s that produced and managed 60% of the world's number one sustainable oil, which is being used in food, which is palm oil. And if you look at the value chain of palm oil, we're talking about a 500 billion ringgit chain in 5 years. Now, this is by no means a small economic ecosystem. So what I feel that we should be really focusing on is the biological side. We heard a lot about the digital transformation. People are talking about digital, but Malaysia is poised to focus on the biological advantage because we are producers. We are moving heavily into sustainable production, and we have to now focus on downstream value chain, including waste. Yeah, including the waste. Now, I'm not sure if many people know, but MPOB's team has actually licensed the technology to Mexican investors to create the world's first commercially produced palm oil phenolics production plant. Yeah, and this is now taken up by a leading mental health wellness company in the US. And I believe they're going to launch their first product using this. Now, if we just look at the nutraceutical market, this is a $2 trillion industry growing at 8% per annum. And what does it do? It's going to create jobs. It's going to create 16 to 25 times more jobs down the line. And these are high value jobs. And what are we doing? We're actually rebuilding humanity by having things on anti-inflammatory vaccine productions that are solving all kinds of issues we're facing in healthcare and food. You know, natural foods, vitamins, and all of this fits nicely into the food security angle. And I think Professor Tajuddin will also be happy because we're dealing with a subject matter that's talking about humanity. It's not about economic greed or taking carbon outside of the earth and so on. So that's my take, Professor Dato, and I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Girish. Those are very pertinent points. I am in complete agreement with you on the fact that Malaysia, we should look more at the biology. You know, although digital is transforming the economy, but biology is our strength. And we have not fully capitalized biology, biotechnology. And of course, in all this that we are discussing, we must not forget the very critical role of communication. As we can see from the pandemic now, one of the biggest stumbling blocks in implementing and enforcing certain rules is the unclarity of communication. So now I would like to invite Datin Dr. Maha to actually address the issue of communication in getting STI to drive the many policies of the country. Please, Dr. Ma.
Thank you, Professor Dato Ahmad Ibrahim. It's really a privilege, an honor to be here at this launch, which is very, very timely. And I congratulate UCSI, congratulate Tan Sri Omar. And I'm so happy to be with Professor Tajuddin sharing the same space, Dato Abu Bakar, and of course, Dato Ahmad Ibrahim, yourself, and Mr. Girish. Prof. Tajuddin has actually explained everything that Abu Bakar spoke about, very niche area, the water problems. And of course, Tan Sri Omar presented the setting the scene. So I purposely asked to be the last panelist because I wanted to tie up all what the previous speakers mentioned in their different roles and see how communication play a big role in science STI development, especially policies and regulations. Now, I don't have to say this. STI is the pillar of any nation. We are seeing the power of science during this pandemic. Dato Peter Ng mentioned this. And we are seeing how healthcare, digitalization, automation, and food security, people are working on all these things. Governments are working on this so that we have the crisis preparedness for now and also for the future. So I say that science has a role to play in all SDGs beyond the pandemic. If we look at the 17 SDGs, science, technology, innovation has a role to play in almost all SDGs, including women empowerment. Because if we can give equal opportunities, funding, and training to women, we are going to see more power in terms of economy, building the nation, building the economy. So development and implementation of science-based policies requires some level of knowledge, scientific knowledge, science knowledge among all policymakers and politicians. Not only science knowledge, but also on current affairs related to science, like this pandemic, food security, climate change, sustainable development, and so on. In many instances, we have excellent policies on science and technology. What we often lack is the implementation, monitoring, and enforcement. I want to bring another issue where science is underestimated. Let us see which ministries are involved in science and what are the policies related to science. What immediately comes to our mind is, of course, MOSTI and Ministry of Education. Are all science-based policies only parked in these ministries? The answer is a big no, because it's just a conservative list of ministries that I'm going to say now, which where science is part of their job. Of course, MOSTI and MOE, Ministry of Education, but there is also health, agriculture, plantation, housing and local development, women, youth and sports, transport, defense, green technology, environment. So, and many other ministries. So the question is, do the policymakers and the officers, the bureaucrats in these ministries realize the importance of science? Are they exposed to the current developments? Are there dialogues regularly to engage them on science, technology, innovation, and what's happening outside Malaysia? What should we be doing? So we need to instill policy awareness among all our bureaucrats. But how do we start? Now, we always look at going immediately and tackling the problem. Now, what I would say is, Professor Tajuddin said it very well, that our STEM graduates, are they just looking at science and looking at their field for the 3 years, 4 years that they're studying, or for the 10 years if they're going to continue with their PhD, masters, or are they looking at the broader areas where whatever they have studied, their field infringes into many other areas? So this is also the same for the researchers. It's not just about studying the science or doing the research, publishing, but being participative in policies and their implementation. And this is where science communication, science diplomacy play a critical role. If not, STI policies will be drawn and implemented by the bureaucrats who do not understand STI, latest development, and how science policies and regulations infringes other sectors like business and trade, environment, health, women and youth empowerment, including spirituality and religion, ethics, and socioeconomic development. And I see this so much because I go for international meetings, I go for UN negotiations, where I see those who are talking are policymakers, bureaucrats, and lawyers. So those are negotiating policies are these people. And the scientists always take a back seat. So this is what we need to change. And I really hope the center will play a big role. And I'm just having a wish list, which I keep talking about this, but I know it's a big dream, to include science communication module unit in all STEM programs in the university. So be it pharmacy, biotechnology, physics, mathematics, engineering, we have to expose our graduates, students, to science communication so that they are able to convey their messages. They're able to communicate with all stakeholders because science is not just the community, is not just scientific community. We work with many other people, including farmers, religious scholars, investors. And how about establishing a science communication center in all universities and research institutes? We have TTOs now. That's a very good progress that we have made, Technology Transfer Office. How about a science communication center so that our scientists get support from trained science communicators when they want to do interviews, when they are going involved in science diplomacy, negotiation, consultation, drawing up policies, talking to politicians? How can these trained science communicators support our scientists? And how about a portion of R&D must be allocated for society and policy engagement? That means if I get $1 million or 1 million ringgit for R&D, can I have like at least 5% of it? I must use that for engaging with the society or policies. So this is where we make it like a small obligation for scientists to be involved beyond the science that they're doing. And KPI for society and policy engagement. So when we, like what Professor Tajuddin said, when we promote our academics from lecturers to senior lecturers and APs to full professors, what have they done to engage the policies, engage the public? So, you know, these are the things that we can make science, democratize science. And also another big tall order is how about having a layperson abstract in journal? So we have an abstract, but can we also include a layperson abstract so that everyone reads science? This is again democratizing science. So I see Tan Sri Omar Center for Science, Technology, Innovation, Policy Studies very timely. And I commend UCSI for this. And I pledge my support in whatever way, whichever platforms that my organization, Malaysian Biotechnology Information Center, has to support the initiatives. I'll be happy to discuss this further and take on questions later. Thank you, Dato' Amar.
Thank you very much, Datin. I'm sure we all agree communication is the key to a lot of these policy issues on implementation. And even during the pandemic, we have seen how communication has been recognized as a very important instrument to build public literacy. Public literacy is a very important element when it comes to implementing policies. So before we go on to the panelists on some other topics related to the main agenda, I have a few questions from the audience. This question of building global spirituality that Prof. Tajuddin has mentioned, they're asking, how do we actually translate it on the ground? How do we get it happening, this global spirituality agenda?
Well, thank you very much. This is one of the question that I intend to deal with in the Tan Sri Omar Center, because this is the next phase of my life, I think. The idea here is that there is no one person who would sit down with all of the other, all the religions, let's say in Malaysia alone, and have the understanding and the tolerance of all of this to actually come up with some sort of idea, let's say a common value system. So if there is a common value system, simple thing like compassion, simple thing like giving dignity to others, this is not discussed. As I said, my data is only on the Friday sermon. I have not actually analyzed the sermons of the Christians or the other religion. But the point here is that if you don't have this as a kind of a common thing, you just give an order. If I were the minister of religion, the first thing I would do is to ask all of them to insert some aspect of history, some aspect of values. What are the contributions of other religion to society? When we came Merdeka, we went on two kind of policy. One is the one history narrative policy. Okay, ada history tak boleh, satu history saja. And the other one is I call the in religion, you call the lulu gua gua policy, meaning you teach religion your way, we won't disturb. Well, sorry guys, it doesn't work. You know, I mean, if you do not teach the others to respect the other religion because of some similarity that you have in terms of values, then this other religion can simply be played by some very naughty politicians to actually break us apart. And that is one part. And in one lecture also, I have put up a policy that in the future, all houses of worship, whether they are mosques, temples, churches, must have 20% built-up area for common usage of others. And this is my area of study on social inclusion in houses of worship. So a lot of this can be done if you have the understanding, and the when you say communication must come first from the heart. You must understand it is important, and then only you can form the words and the other things. Sometimes whatever words you have empty of this idea of the spirituality or soul, then it's very difficult to actually do.
Well, Prof. Tajuddin, the position of Minister of Religion is open now, so you can apply. What about the other panelists? Do you have some response to what has been spoken by the other panelists? We can have a cross-panelist discussion. Dr. Baka, you have anything that you want to project in terms of your opinion, what has been discussed, communication, industry involvement, and all those societal impact?
Yeah, maybe I would like to pick up what Prof. Datuk Tajuddin was saying earlier.
Yeah.
On the humanities, on the religious part, you know, and but the crisis, the way I see it, nothing to do with whether we understand the other religions. Mm. You know, the crisis that I see, for instance, as a Muslim, we don't even understand what a Muslim ought to be. That's the problem. You claim yourself to be Muslim, but you're not Muslim. You don't practice what has been taught in Al-Quran and Hadith. And this is the problem. You know, we only born to be Muslim, but we're not really Muslims. Sorry to say that. And, you know, it's very difficult for them to understand other religion if they themselves do not know what to be Muslim is all about. So I think that's the reason of the crisis. And of course, as you see, then the subject of Islam has been politicized, you know. I, for one, do not understand, you know, why you have Parti Islam Malaysia. You know what I mean? Right? You know, because, you know, Islam is not to be politicized, you know. Islam is, you know, it's a religion. And I think maybe we should emphasize, if you are Muslim, you better be a good Muslim. You know, I think that will solve many problems. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, maybe it's time we start the Green Party, Datuk. Not the Green Islamic Party.
In every sense, not politically speaking, but also environmentally speaking. Yeah, right.
Yes. I mean, if you look at Germany, the Green Party now has a very big say in the government.
Yeah.
So I think if you start small, we can go that way as well.
I just have a comment on the Green Parties in the Europe, Dato and Omar and Dato Abu Bakar. I know everyone is being green, but then when we be green, we must also be sustainable, and we must also embrace technology. Because many Green Parties in the Europe, we know they just shun technology. They don't want nuclear technology. They don't want gene technologies. That's not really being green. That is having vested ideologies, vested interest. So we being green is good. I'm green. I love nature. I all those things. But then technology is what is going to help us to sustain the green. So we have to understand how science play a role in green technology. I'm sure Dr. Bakar is an expert. I don't have to tell him.
Yeah, we are running close to the end of the forum because we're supposed to stop at 11:30. So I would like to invite our Tan Sri Omar now to actually give his own take on what has been discussed and also the question that has been raised, the few questions that have been raised. Please, Tan Sri.
Yeah, not sure how to sum this up. The idea in my scene setting was just simply to identify some key element that needs to be in place if you want a policy or an intention to be implemented successfully. First of all, you need to have the people. That's what the pyramid is. And in the pyramid, communication comes third. The first one must be the champion. Somebody must champion whatever you want to do. Somebody must champion what Prof. Tajuddin is trying to do that. He alone cannot champion that. For such a big agenda, you need a very, very big champion to do that. And I cannot see in the country now who can do that. Unless the Prime Minister himself is like that, that is the supreme champion to move an agenda.
Prime Minister's post also vacant, Tan Sri.
Okay. No, so that's what I'm trying. So the pyramid says if you want to do something, you need the champion.
Yeah.
We are all champion for STI. It doesn't work unless number one. So during Dr. Mahathir's time, he was the supreme champion. That's why things work. And then for the champion to understand things, he needs an advisor. And there is a whole collection of people advising. The third one is the popularizers. This is what Datin Maha has been trying to say. You need people to actually translate that into something that the citizen can understand and can support, can embrace, can all that. So what Prof. Tajuddin wants to do requires the whole of that triangle. The champion, the advisors, the popularizers, the planners, the educators, and the actual people on the ground doing that. And I do not see that before I die. I believe in the same way you do. And I have been doing that long before, but I cannot see anything happening like changing that attitude in Malaysia. Because thinking that, just thinking the way you do, is anti-Islam, according to some people. Never mind putting that in place. And I'm worried because the way things are happening in this area, the younger generation cannot accept what the Muslim religious leaders are now promoting. I see that in my own family. My son cannot accept that. So we are actually creating potential clashes among the Muslim in Malaysia. But to see that change, we need a whole citizens movement. I don't know how you're going to do that, but you need a big champion. So I sympathize with Tajuddin, but I don't see that before I go away. Now,
all right. Thank you.
Now just finally, yeah.
Yes, please.
I want to go back to the ACCA, awareness, comprehension, commitment, and action. So we all can do this. Any issues, we need to create awareness, we need to create understanding. Issue of religion, issue of science and technology, issue of green, issue of SDG. You have to create awareness, you have to create understanding, and you have to create commitment for action, not just by somebody else, but by us as individual or as group, as individual. So if we can do that at our own level, at the center's level, that is the approach I think we can all do, and we can take small steps before everything else, the big things can happen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tan Sri, for those concluding thoughts. And since we are out of time, I once again would like to thank all the panelists for coming forward to share your views. In fact, the conclusion, as Tan Sri puts, is that we scientists, we write in journals, we write in all kinds of academic communication platforms. But what matters to the common people, what matters to the country, is the policy. The business looks at policy, the people looks at policy. So unless all the work in science are not translated into the right policy to drive harmony, prosperity, sustainability, then science is meaningless. So I hope this our center will be performing that role to catalyze thinking for scientists to actually more be engaged in society and to contribute to the formulation of robust policy to drive the prosperity and harmony and progressiveness and sustainability of the country. Thank you very much again to everyone. And now I just pass back to Ruben. Please, Ruben. Unmute, Ruben.
Thank you, Professor Dato' Dr. Ahmad Ibrahim, guests of honor, panelists, and our virtual viewers for being with us today. To celebrate this momentous occasion, we would like to invite everyone for a photo session. You may pose with a thumbs up before your camera.
All right, we are. Okay. Everyone ready?
Okay. Dato Peter. Okay.
All right. In 3, 2, 1, and okay. It's good. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. As we bring our ceremony to a close, I once again thank our esteemed guests and everyone for tuning from home for joining us on this memorable day. Thank you and stay safe.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye. Thank you.